year in life.
So good morning, friends. Again a fresh week beginning, and we are in the final week of our webinar journey. Thanks to the God Almighty for making this international webinar in a successful progressing. Thanks to St. John the Baptist University for the initiation. Thanks to the Eugene University for its association. And today, after completion of our big journey, we have seen a lot of information related with the skills. We have seen a lot of information related with entrepreneurship. And we have seen a lot of professionals who was handling the sessions in the earlier stages. We have discussed about the career choice. We have discussed about the employment traits. We have discussed about the goal setting. We have discussed about the entrepreneurship, successful entrepreneurship traits, scopes, features and the futures of entrepreneurship. A lot of big professionals from India across the nation speak about those things about with you. And today and the last week of this international webinar, we are going to discuss about the skills. The majority portions, almost all the days, we are going to discuss about the skills. What are all the skills which can lead you to the great success in your career journey? That's what we are going to discuss. And today we are having a doctor with us. Today we are having a doctor, a dentist with us. I would like to share some information about her. I think you are all seeing the screen. I would like to introduce Dr. A.M. Antra Ashmi. She is a dental surgeon. Her academic qualification is BDS. And she is a house surgeon at Vivekananda Dental College. It is the largest institution in Asia, actually, which is running with 26,000 women students, actually. It's a women's institution. And she is a house surgeon at Vivekananda Dental College, Tamil Nadu, India. And about her representations, she was presented and won more than 10 papers and posters in international and national conferences. And she was awarded best papers and posters too. And she published 2 review articles and original article in indexed journals, actually. What are all the indexed journals? We can see her articles in these international journals. International Journal of Oral Health Dentistry, International Journal of Applied Dental Sciences, International Journal of Clinical Biochemistry and Research. Approval of a research paper by ICMR. They are the leaders of Indian Council of Medical Research, ICMR, Delhi, India. And she is having her academic distinction in General Human Physiology and Biochemistry, General Pathology and Microbiology, Oral Medicine and Radiology, Conservative Dentistry and Endodontics. And this wonderful young doctor, young surgeon, today she is going to share some beautiful thoughts related with what, as you all know very well about our today's topic, emotional intelligences or emotional intelligence, EI, people will call, or somebody will call us, call that as EQ. So today, an important soft skill which leads you to the great career success. We have come across in our life, there are a lot of people across the world who are very good in IQ. They are having very good track record in their schools. They are having very good track record in the colleges. And you know, after that, when you notice their career journey, it's a pathetic situation. We are seeing very less amount of people who are having very good IQ are successful in their career journey. But whereas there is another statistics also stating, people from normal education background, their IQ level is very normal during their schooling, during their college. But fortunately, when you are seeing their career journey, they were in the very higher positions actually. How this happens? Absolutely because of emotional intelligences. How everybody is having intelligence. How we are utilizing that intelligence. Because every day you are going to deal with emotions. Once you are starting your career journey, every day you are going to deal people with a lot of emotions. Every day you are going to handle situations full of emotions. So you should know how to handle emotions very intelligently. Then only we will be seeing a lot of families. There is a quarrel between parents, quarrel between parents and son, daughters, children, everyone, they are quarreling. What? Because, you know, they are not understanding other people's emotion. Without understanding other people's emotion, there will be a stress naturally. So, emotional intelligence. Today, such a valid topic we are going to discuss. That too with the dental surgeon. Now, with all your applause, I'll be handing over the session to Dr. Anto Ashby. Welcome, Doctor, to the show. Now, the session is yours, ma'am.
A very happy morning to everyone present. I offer my greetings with love and care. The topic I intend to present today is emotional intelligence, and it gives me a lot of pleasure, for which I should offer my gratitude sincerely to St. John the Baptist University, Malawi, and St. Eugene's University, Zambia. So the topic I intend to present today is emotional intelligence. By now, you all would have a perception of what it is. Leaving our perspectives aside, I'll put it into simple terms. Emotional intelligence is the ability of a person to perceive emotions, to integrate them in their own minds, and to regulate those emotions to end up in a resultant action. And that action should be in such a way that it promotes beneficial personal growth. So with this a very brief introduction about emotional intelligence, I would like you all to see a video. So I request Rajkumar sir to play the video, please. Sir, could you please increase the volume of the video? Okay, I assume you all would have seen the video by now. Let me narrate it in a very brief manner. There were two athletes. The first one was named Abel Mutai, and he was a Kenyan athlete. And the second one was Ivan Fernandez, and he was a Spanish athlete. Both of them participated in a running competition, which was held in Spain. So it was the native place of Ivan Fernandez. During the final round of the running competition, the video visualized Abel Mutai running forward, running ahead of Ivan Fernandez. At some point, he feels a confusion. And that confusion was about the finish line. He was not sure about the finish line. He was 10 meters before the finish line where he was subjected to that confusion. Now, he needs some help. The people around them, the crowd, tried helping the Kenyan athlete, Abel Mutai, by telling him that the finish line is 10 meters ahead. But he did not understand that because he was a Kenyan and the persons nearby spoke in Spanish language. With this confusion, he slowed down moment by moment. That instance, Ivan Fernandez decided to help him out. He could have used that opportunity to help him, or he could have even used that opportunity to gain victory by overcoming him. He would have definitely encountered many thoughts in his mind. He would have thought about himself. He would have picturized his victory at his home with his acquaintances. He would have picturized his victory and the appreciation he could have received from the mother nation. But his emotional intelligence was that shined on. He decided to pat the back of Abel Mutai. He decided to encourage him. He decided to tell him about the real finish line. So he did, and Abel Mutai continued. He won the race. After the competition, after the honoring ceremony, obviously the reporters would come and question Ivan Fernandez about it. So they did. And when they did, Ivan Fernandez replied, "I would have experienced the victory, but that victory would never be worth enough for me." That was the reply he gave. He also said that victory would never be acceptable to him, his mother, or his mother nation. So this value that Ivan Fernandez possessed is called emotional intelligence. It just takes a matter of few minutes to few seconds or few minutes. So you have to decide in that juncture what to do and what not to do. You have to find a link between what you think and what you do. In simple terms, this is emotional intelligence. Now we'll enter into the presentation. Just give me a minute so that I could share my screen. Okay, so we are entering into the presentation. The topic is emotional intelligence. I've told a very simple definition of what it means. In simple terms, it is the ability you possess to perceive the emotions, integrate them, regulate them in your own mind to result in an action that is going to be beneficial for yourself and for others. Before entering into the topic, it is very essential for us to know about the concept and the development of emotional intelligence. So we'll see about the history. The concept of emotional intelligence was first given by Howard Gardner in one of his books called Frames of Mind, The Theory of Multiple Intelligences. He spoke about many different types of intelligences in that, among which emotional intelligence is one. He has explained about traditional models of intelligence, interpersonal intelligence, and intrapersonal intelligence. We'll deal with the traditional models of intelligence later. Now, interpersonal intelligence. It is that ability you possess. It is the ability with which you understand the emotions and motivations of other people. On the other hand, intrapersonal intelligence is the ability with which you understand your emotions, your feelings, and your motivations that drive you towards your goal and objective. The concept was introduced by him. However, the term emotional intelligence was not used by him in his book. So when did the term come into existence? It was only after Wayne Payne published his PhD thesis on a study of emotion, developing emotional intelligence. So the credit of using the term emotional intelligence for the first time goes to Wayne Payne, and this happened back in 1985. However, the term did not gain popularization by then. So it was Daniel Goleman who took measures to make the term very popular. It was in his book called Emotional Intelligence, Why It Can Matter More Than Intelligence Quotient. We'll see about the difference between emotional intelligence and intelligence quotient later. So it was since 1995, the term was well known among the people of the world. So what is the need for emotional intelligence? There are many a times when you feel demotivated. For instance, let's take your academic life. You meet with a failure, be it in a subject or an exam totally. You meet with a failure. You feel the stress. You become so vulnerable to take up a new task. You feel weak. You lose your self-confidence from then on. You can no more think positively. You end up in a conclusion where you think you are not good enough to pursue things. It genuinely takes less than a couple of minutes to figure out why you gain this mindset and the ways to overcome this mindset. After thinking, I'm sure we all would arrive at this statement. I don't think I can change it myself. But I would certainly deny this. There are multiple ways to overcome this mindset of yours. I wouldn't say emotional intelligence is the only way to do it, but one way to achieve it is through emotional intelligence. I assume you all would have understood the need for emotional intelligence by now. So now, we'll concentrate on the definition of emotional intelligence. There are three parts in this definition. It can very well be divided into three distinct parts. The first one is the ability to recognize one's own and other people's emotions. The second one is to discriminate between different feelings, to label them appropriately. And the third one is to use emotional information to guide thinking and behavior. Now we'll see in detail about the first part. The ability to recognize one's own and other people's emotions. You become capable enough to detect or decipher the emotions of people, be it from an image or from a voice or from a person. That ability you possess to detect that emotion from them is called your ability to recognize. So you have to be good enough to recognize yours and other people's emotions. And the second part is discrimination. There are certainly many different types of emotions. You have to be capable enough to discriminate between the different feelings, and you have to label them appropriately. For example, let me take a feeling of happiness, for instance. That the term happiness is very closely related with pleasure. It is very closely related with joy and happiness. So all these may sound different, but they do have similar meanings. But being sensitive to even that slightest variation among emotions is this second part. The third one is using emotional information to guide thinking and behavior. That is, you have detected an emotion, you have discriminated that into a type of emotion, and now you have to use this emotional information to guide your thinking and behavior, because it is only with the combination of emotional responses and cognitive responses your brain enables you to do an action. So it is very crucial to use your emotional information to guide thinking and behavior. So let's assume we've all learned emotional intelligence. Now, what can you expect at the end of this session or after you master the emotional intelligence? When I kept thinking of this topic, two questions arose in my mind. The first one was, who is in need of emotional intelligence? And the second one was, how we should inculcate that into them? So the answer to the first question is, it is definitely in the childhood, because Childhood is the most influential period of your entire life. You receive a lot of pressure from your peer groups, friends, and families. That is the period where you build your self-esteem and self-confidence. So it is very significant to be very highly emotionally intelligent since childhood. When you are highly intelligent in emotions, you are able and you are capable to establish good, better social relationships with everyone. Highly emotionally intelligent individuals are perceived more positively by others. This is because they have a better perception of themselves. They have a better perception of the society. When a person's social concerns is really well, other persons in the society obviously perceive them to be the most optimistic among all. When you are highly emotionally intelligent, you obviously establish intimate relationships with everyone in your family. This is because you'll be able to comprehend between the different types of emotions of yours and others. Obviously, a person who is proficient enough in academics will have a better work performance. This helps you to become a psychologically healthy person. The last one is self-compassion. That is very, 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 very significant because you have to love yourself for what you are and who you are. Not only your positives, we are after all human beings. We do have negatives, but we should take care that the negatives don't come and mask the positives in us. So be it your negative point or a positive attitude you have, whatever be it, you have to love yourself for what and who you are. So before entering into the learning process of emotional intelligence, I would like to explain 8 different types of emotions. These 8 different types of emotions were put forward by Robert Plutchik. He had also stated that one set of these 8 emotions can be closely linked and easily altered to another 4 of these emotions. So the first one is anticipation. In simple terms, I'll make sure I explain all the 8 emotions to you. Anticipation is a state of expecting something with greater eagerness. That need not necessarily be a good event. It is yet to happen and you're expecting something with a great eagerness. You call it anticipation. You anticipate something. So this is the first emotion of all the 8. The closely linked emotion to this is surprise. Surprise is a feel you encounter when something unexpected has occurred to you. So it is a shocking experience. The third emotion is anger. Anger is a feel of rage. It may be against someone or something. It is often accompanied with an urge to harm others. Another emotion closely linked to this is fear. Fear is an uncontrollable, unpleasantable feeling that you have developed because of something you've perceived already. One emotion that is not mentioned here is anxiety. It is oftentimes confused with fear. When you perceived something before and you feel an unpleasant feeling towards it, that's called fear. When you've not perceived something, but with the knowledge from outside, you fear something, that is termed as anxiety. The next one is sadness. Sadness and joy are very lay terms, you'll understand. Sadness is a state of being sad and joy is a state of being happy and cheerful. The 7th emotion is disgust. This is an emotion that you develop. It is a strong dislike that you develop against something or someone. And then it is the acceptance. I find this the most important for emotional intelligence. You have to have a heart that will enable you to accept things, be it good or bad. This takes a lot of self-trust to do it. Okay, so now I guess you all would have a basic idea of what are the different types of emotions. So next is the models of emotional intelligence. As seen before, Howard was the first person to introduce the concept of EI. He was the first person to also speak about 3 different models of emotional intelligence. The first model is ability model. The second one is trait model. And the third one is mixed model. We'll see about the ability model in detail. It was developed by Peter Salovey and John Mayer in 1989. They defined EI as the ability to perceive emotions, integrate emotions to facilitate thought. Because perceiving emotions will just not help you to facilitate your cognitive thinking. It definitely needs some sort of integration in your emotional part of the brain. We'll deal with that later. The second part of the definition is understand and regulate emotions to promote personal growth. To promote personal growth is the most significant part of the definition, because that is what is emotional intelligence mainly. So according to them, there are four types of abilities that could help you master the emotional intelligence. As we saw, the first part is perceiving emotions. Like I told before, it is the ability to detect and decipher an emotion from an image or from a voice or from a person's trait. So that is perceiving emotions. The second one is using emotions. You've detected an emotion from someone or something. You are harnessing that emotion to regulate or facilitate your cognitive thinking. That is using emotions. The first one is detecting emotions. The second one is harnessing the detected emotion to facilitate your cognitive thinking. And the third one is understanding emotions. You have to understand that perceiving emotions and understanding emotions are certainly two different entities. Perceiving emotions is just observing something, you're detecting something. But understanding emotions is being able to comprehend the slightest variations among the different types of emotions. So this is understanding emotions. You have to be sensitive enough to even the smallest of variation among them. And the final thing is managing emotions. This is a very crucial thing, because you have to be able enough to manage emotions to result in an action, because only that action is going to enable you to be a very optimistic person and to be very highly emotionally intelligent. So these are the abilities that make up emotional intelligence, is what the authors thought about it. The next one is trait model. Trait model is in contrast to the ability model, because ability is something that you gain after your birth. But trait is genetic. It is a characteristic that is innately present in your human body. The term simply means a characteristic that is transmitted genetically generation after generation. So this was developed by Konstantinos Vasilis Petridis. According to him, trait model is a constellation of emotional self-perceptions located at the lower levels of their personality. Constellation is simply a collection of emotional self-perceptions. So it is determined already when you are born. It is present in the lower level of your personality, which implies that it is not subject to any changes. So this is measured by self-report. Now you all would have a question, how is ability model measured? I forgot to tell you that ability model can be measured with the help of questionnaires. There are many questionnaires that have developed. So you can utilize them to measure your ability model of emotional intelligence. Now, self-report means you have to self-assess. You have to be aware of what you do, what you think, what you say, what you feel, and what emotion you have. So that is trait model. The third one is mixed model, and this is the most accepted model. This model was introduced by Professor Daniel Goleman. So he was the first person to make the term emotional intelligence more popular among the people of the world. So he belonged to Harvard University, and in 1998, he introduced this mixed model. This model focuses on EI as a wide range of competencies and skills that drive leadership performance. This part of the emotional intelligence was described in What Makes a Leader. This is an article by Professor Daniel Goleman. According to him, they are not innate talents, but rather learned capabilities. So emotional intelligence, one good news about emotional intelligence is you can learn it in the course of your life. Within each component of EI, he has described about the learned capabilities. So EI comprises five major components. They are empathy, self-regulation, self-awareness, motivation, and social skills. The first one is empathy. Now, let me tell you a story for you to understand the difference between empathy and sympathy. Let's assume you are sitting in a car. It's raining outside. You're traveling to a place. You don't find it comfortable to travel anymore. So you stop. You halt in a place. You are very cozy and comfortable in that place. But you see a person outside. He is not comfortable. He's getting wet in the rain. So this pettiness you show for him is called sympathy. But what is empathy? It is a totally different entity, but it is related to sympathy. You feel pity for him, you call it sympathy. But you do something to make him comfortable. You like you go and offer him an umbrella, you go and give him a raincoat, or you make him comfortable in a shelter. So that action that results out of the sympathy you feel for him is empathy. That is what makes you empathetic enough in a life. Second one is self-regulation. Self-regulation is it is a quality that you possess for yourself. People with self-regulation keep moving persistently towards the goals and objectives. They have certain principles and rules in their lives. So this is self-regulation. And the third one is self-awareness. You have to be aware of your positive points, your negatives, and everything. So that is self-awareness. The fourth one is motivation. Motivation is simply a term that means you have willingness to learn something new or doing something new. That inner potential that keeps you willing enough to do and undertake things is called motivation. And the fifth one is social skills. Social skills simply means the concerns you have about the society you live in. That is called social skills. We'll see about this in detail. It's definitely very easy for us to master these five elements of emotional intelligence. Anyone who masters these five elements will definitely be very high in emotional intelligence. So we'll see about these in detail now. The first one is empathy. People who are empathetic enough or attentive to emotional cues. And this is the reason why empathetic people are always happy to listen to other people. They show sensitivity and comprehend other people's perspective. It is a very, very important part of emotional intelligence. Hearing someone, observing them, and being able to help them is not only the core part of emotional intelligence, but you have to understand things from other people's perspectives. Empathetic people are strong enough in doing this. They help out people and they offer appropriate assistance when in need. People with higher empathy offer appropriate assistance when time in need, and they are always service oriented. So in professional life, they acknowledge and reward people's strength, acknowledge accomplishments and developments. It is very easy to master this skill. So initially you have to be attentive enough. You have to show sensitivity to people. You have to help them when they are in need, and you have to acknowledge and reward people's strength, accomplishments and developments. It is the most important part of empathy. So what are the hallmarks you should possess? A person who is rich in emotional intelligence should possess the following hallmarks. The first one is expertise in building and retaining talent. To understand this, you should initially know the difference between talent and skill. Talent is something that is present innately. By birth, you possess something. People who sing, people who dance well, people who sing well, people who speak well, they all possess this talent from birth, since birth. It is your responsibility and role to retain the talent and build that talent. So people who are empathetic enough show expertise in building and retaining that talent. The second one is cross-cultural sensitivity. In a workplace, you may follow, not only in your workplace, let's assume your personal life, you encounter certain beliefs, you do some acts, you have certain behaviors that are unique to your culture. You cannot expect the same to be with your colleague in your workplace. So just as you respect your beliefs and your behaviors, you should be good enough to respect the cross-cultural beliefs and behaviors. So that is called cross-cultural sensitivity. The third one is service to clients and customers. I've told about this earlier in the qualities of being an empathetic person. So people like them are always service oriented. So they are the most sought after people in professional life. The last but important one is ability to develop others. The other three things can result from a normal individual. But one thing that makes you empathetic enough is this ability to develop others. You have to work for the beneficial growth of other persons. So these are the qualities people expect from you when you are high in empathy. The second element of emotional intelligence is self-regulation. self-regulative people efficiently manage even the disruptive emotions. We might not always end up with having pleasurable emotions. We do have disruptive emotions and impulses coming up from your brain, heart, and mind. It is very essential to manage them efficiently and effectively. So that is the first thing about self-regulation. People with self-regulation are often focused and they are always composed enough. They are optimistic. One important thing about self-regulation is even during the tiring moments of trial, you should not be unflappable. You should remain unflappable during tiring moments of trials. They have clear and focused thoughts, like I've told before. These people are the most ethical people to be with. With their reliability and authenticity, they become more trustworthy. These are the very genuine people to move with in professional life and in personal life. So what are the hallmarks of self-regulation? The first one is trustworthiness, because these people are authentic enough and reliable enough. This automatically makes them trustworthy to the eyes of others. The second one is integrity. Integrity, I need not explain integrity. You have to have this quality of integrity to be self-regulative. And the third one is comfort with ambiguity and change. You have to accept changes in the course of life and in the course of work as they come. And then this is ambiguity. Ambiguity means, for a thought, you have different perceptions. You have to subject one thinking of yours to different perceptions. That is called ambiguity. You have to be clear enough and accept, and you have to have a ability to accept things as they come, and you have to be good enough to accept the changes in their way. So all these are very important for being self-regulative. The third one is self-awareness. People who possess this competency know what emotions they feel, and they always find a link with what they feel and what they think and do. They are reflective enough, and they readily learn from their experiences. This is a very, very significant quality that self-aware people possess. They keep their minds always open to constructive criticisms. They have candid feedbacks coming. They are capable of showing a good sense of humor, and with the constructive criticisms and candid feedbacks, they have a better perception of things. So what are the hallmarks of self-aware people? First one is self-confidence. Second one is self-assessment. Third one is self-deprecation. Fourth one is sense of humor. And the fifth one is thirst for constructive criticism. The next element of emotional intelligence is motivation. So motivation is a willingness to do something new. You take up a new task, a novel task you take up. You definitely need motivation and willingness to do it. So that is called self-motivation. You have to be self-motivated at times. So people who possess this competency of motivation strive to meet a standard of excellence. People like them are result-oriented. It is not a negative part. It may seem like a negative point, but it is definitely not a negative point. It is a very optimistic way of approaching things. You have to be result-oriented with an increased drive to meet their goals. You can take calculated risks. You cannot take risks in all aspects, but do calculate what will work out and what will not work out. So take only calculated risks in your professional life. People with this competency, they reduce the uncertainty in all ways possible. And they find happiness in finding a sense of purpose in everything that they do. Finding a sense of purpose in the works you undertake is a very, very important thing that you have to be clear with. You have to find happiness in getting a sense of satisfaction in whatever you do. So what are the hallmarks of motivation? First one is having a strong drive to achieve. Second one is being optimistic even in the face of failure. And the third one is people who possess motivation, self-motivate. And people who are self-motivated obviously have a commitment towards their organization. The next one is having social skills. People who are having higher social concerns are skilled at persuading things with determination. They fine-tune everything to make them seem more appealing. They seek mutual understanding and are all ears to open criticisms and comments. That is very, very important, because in a society, many people live. You have to gain a mutual understanding from people. You cannot succeed with you being yourself. You have to throw some spotlight on every individual of a society to be highly emotionally intelligent. You have to be capable of handling difficult people and even tense situations. You cannot simply cope up with these difficult situations and tense situations. You have to master the act of diplomacy, and you should have the knack of proceeding things, progressing things with tact. And then they spot the potential conflicts that are already present in the society, and they help to de-escalate them. De-escalating the conflicts present in the society is very important to have a healthy society around you. Okay, now the content I'm sharing here may seem a little too biological, but I'll make sure I understand in a better way possible. Okay, so in the course of evolution, many organs in your human body developed into a complex structure. This is proven in literature. You can read them if you want. So the most complex organ of our human body is human brain. There are many different parts of your human brain. Let us not see about them in detail. We'll concentrate about the emotional part of your brain. To make you all understand, I'll put it into simple terms. Your brain has two parts. One is associated with emotional thinking, and the other one is associated with cognitive thinking. You need both of them to result in a highly emotionally intelligent person, as a highly emotionally intelligent person. So the first one is brainstem. So these three areas are associated with the emotional responses that arise from your brain. The first one is brainstem, and the second one is hippocampus, and the third one is neocortex. Few of you would have learned about this and would remember the terms, but it is not a problem even if you don't. The first one is brainstem. The brainstem forms a link between your inner self and the external surroundings. It is only with the help of this brainstem, informations enter into your brain. It is like a single point of entry. The informations enter your brain either with your consciousness or without your consciousness. But a good thing about this is even the informations that have entered the brain in your unconscious state can very well be converted into a conscious information and stored for later purpose. So you learn by imitation, avoidance, and repetition. These three actions are associated with brainstem. You imitate something, avoid something, or repeat something until it becomes a habit. So this is the function of brainstem. Second part, it is the higher level when compared to the brainstem. So this is the second part in the progressing of a emotion. It is hippocampus. It is strongly associated with intuitions, hunches, and gut reactions. A two-year-old kid may not have experienced a lot of events just like you do. So that is the difference in the hippocampus. The hippocampus of a two-year-old will have lesser number of experiences when compared to you. You learn from experiences. That is the role of hippocampus. It helps you to think about things after analyzing the previous experiences that have already been stored in your mind. The third one is neocortex. Neocortex is the highest level of the limbic system, and it is associated with planning, questioning, making decisions, and solving problems. So you use these two emotions to arrive at a plan, to make a question, to make decision, or to solve a problem. This is the part of the brain that helps utilize your emotions and regulate them into an action. Now, the reason I speak about this biological thing is because the survival is less of a threat to us when compared with the primitive men. The emotional responses arising from the brain, however, remain to be the same. It is that amount and measure of these responses you utilize in your activities. You have to understand what emotional response is arising from your brain, and you have to be able to relate this emotional responses with the cognitive thinking that your mind tells you. So with the result of these two, you have to do the best thing possible to get the better things out of every activity you do. And I should also tell you that emotional responses arise a few milliseconds earlier than the cognitive responses. So you have to be good enough to relate both emotional and cognitive responses is the conclusion of this part. The next one is emotional quotient and intelligence quotient. These two terms are entirely different terms, but they are oftentimes confused with one another. They are also used, like one term is used in place of another mistakenly. So it's not about the difference of EQ and IQ. EQ is what we are speaking about now. Emotional quotient is the measure of your ability and how you perceive things, integrate them, and put them into action. Whereas intelligence quotient is different from emotional quotient. Intelligence quotient is just a measure of your relative intelligence. So it is very essential to know the difference between these two. Also, it is very essential to know which plays a major role in success. So the answer to this is emotional quotient. It is a 4 times more important key factor for success when compared to intelligence quotient. We spend years of a school life going to schools and colleges only to increase our intelligence quotient. But do we spend sufficient time to increase and make your emotional quotient better? It is definitely a no, but I would suggest you should. It is very significant and crucial to spend at least few minutes to hours a day to improve your emotional quotient, because that is what is heart smart. IQ is book smart. So now we'll see about the differences. Intelligence quotient and emotional quotient. Let's assume you go for an interview and you get a job. So from then on, we'll see what is IQ and EQ. Intelligence quotient helps you get the job. That is what you learn from schools and colleges. But emotional quotient helps you succeed at the job. IQ measures the ability to learn and understand. EQ measures your emotional and logical skills. Like I've told before, it is very, very important to succeed in your professional life. IQ tries to convince a person by facts. It purely relies on facts, whereas EQ tries to convince by emotional appeal and reasoning, because emotional appeal and reasoning play an important role in the emotions of other persons. The way you make them perceive this emotion is how they perceive it and make a conclusion out of it. Like I told before, IQ is book smart and EQ is heart smart. A person who's proficient enough in both IQ and EQ has no limits to succeed. Sky is the limit for such persons. So can emotional intelligence be learned? The answer to this is yes. Research shows that emotional intelligence can be learned, although it has a genetic component. So this is based on the trait model. So you possess a trait that is inherited from your maternal and paternal influence. So you also can learn it through the course of life. So this is the best news about today's presentation. Emotional intelligence is born largely in the neurotransmitters of the brain's limbic system. This was what we discussed earlier. That is the hippocampus, the neocortex, and the brainstem. They comprise the limbic system. It governs feelings, impulses, and drives. It learns through motivation, extended practice, and feedback. So the learning process of emotional intelligence must help people break old behavioral habits and establish new ones. So this is the learning process. The first one is self-assessment. The second one is self-awareness. The third one is self-knowledge. The fourth one is self-development. And the final thing is self-improvement. So initial thing is self-assessment. You have to evaluate. Exploration and evaluation of your attitudes and behavior is self-assessment. Second one is identifying your current skill levels. You have to be aware. You have to know what you possess and what you don't possess. So that skill you have and that skill you don't have, and the level, you have to know the degree or measure of the skill you possess. That is being self-aware. The third one is self-knowledge. It is knowing. Being aware is different from knowing things. You are able to comprehend better with self-knowledge. So the fourth one is self-development. You have to develop something that you don't possess from the scratch. That is self-development. And the final thing is self-improvement. You've developed something. Let's assume you've developed a skill of speaking to persons. Communication is a very important skill. So let's assume you have mastered the skill of communication. You have to keep improving it. Improvisation is very important in maintaining and retaining a skill. So you have to apply, practice, and develop the skills. So first, you have to explore your attitudes and behavior, identify your current skill levels, understand your skill levels better, learn to use self-directed coaching and mentoring to learn the skills, new skills, and then apply, practice, and develop the skills. Now, I'd like to tell you about a tale of two persons. There were two students named Penn and Matt. Penn was a brilliant and creative student. He was an exemplar of the best a university had to offer. The trouble with Penn was that he knew he was so exceptional. And so even one of the professors put it, unbelievably arrogant. Even though he looked so spectacular on paper, he called him that way. When he graduated, naturally, he was highly sought after and got a lot of invitations from the job interviews. But Penn's arrogance came along with him in all the interviews. And he ended up with one job offer from a second tier outfit. So the second person was Matt. Matt, on the other hand, was not academically proficient enough like Penn, but he was adept interpersonally. That is an important tool of emotional intelligence. You have to be adept enough interpersonally. Being adept interpersonally will lead you there. Everyone who worked with Matt liked him. He ended up with 7 job offers out of 8 interviews, and he went on to succeed in his field. Whereas Penn was let go after 2 years of his first job. So I guess the difference between Penn and Matt by now would have been very clear to you. The quality that Matt possessed and Penn lacked is called emotional competence. Emotional competence is very, very relatable to emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence applies for your personal life, whereas emotional competence applies for your professional life. So let's see what emotional competence is. It is a learned capability, so you can learn it. Based on emotional intelligence, we've told before, they are very interrelatable. It results in outstanding performance at work. Like I've told before, it applies to your professional life rather than a personal life. It determines a potential for learning the practical skills. And this is based on Daniel Goleman's 5 elements that we've discussed before. Self-awareness, motivation, self-regulation, empathy, and social skills. So, what are the requisites for an effective career? If you do not know where you're going, any road will get you to any destiny. The less aware you are of what makes you passionate, the more lost you will be. So it is definitely necessary to determine what you like, to decipher that from the rest of the things. You have to be good enough to discern what you like and what you don't like. So set a goal or objective. And you keep progressing towards it with principles and rules, of course. Only with principles you can go in a self-regulated path. So I've mentioned 8 different qualities that you have to master for an effective career. The first one is presence of mind. The second one is the art of listening. The third one is empathy. The fourth one is managed heart. 5th one is self-awareness, 6th is curiosity, 7th is motivation, and the last one is optimism. It is very, very essential to master yourself with these 8 arts. So the first one is presence of mind. These are certain ways you can use to master yourself with the art of presence of mind. Listen attentively, be observant, learn to multitask, don't carry emotional baggage, help yourself prioritize your tasks, chill out, explore the tension of being the center of attention, move your body, and be real with yourself. So first one is listening attentively. Some people like to talk more and hear less. But in order to build a rapport with every individual, you need to know what other people are saying. So do not switch off when a person is speaking to you. This is the first thing you have to master to learn presence of mind. Do not switch off when someone is speaking to you. Second one is being observant. Presence of mind basically implies focus and concentration. So it's very significant that you observe them to be able to do something for them. In the end, only that matters. The third one is learn to multitask. If you're not good enough in multitasking, please don't multitask. Sometimes people lack presence of mind because they do different types of tasks in one particular time. When they are engaged in an activity, they are busy thinking about it, that they lack paying good amount of attention to the task at hand. So it is very significant to learn to multitask. Don't carry emotional baggage. We are, after all, humans, so we cannot compartmentalize our life. We do have personal problems. They may become unbearable at times that you cannot stop thinking about them in your workplace. But you have to be very shrewd enough to be in a good mindset to not carry emotional baggage. The next one is help prioritize your tasks. You need to learn to prioritize your tasks. If there's something that needs to be done very importantly and urgently, you have to try to get it done so that the thought of it does not nag all the day long. Next one is chilling out. It is a very late term. Be cool, because only being cool will help you achieve things. If you realize you are tensed, you have to explore the tension. That is the next point. Explore the tension of being the center of attention. Find out where you tense yourself, where you tense up and block energy in your body. Because when people are attentive on you, you obviously tend to block energy, and that is where you start to tense up. It is very essential to give yourself the permission to reflect on it. You have to be very relaxed enough until you feel a flow of things. So this is about exploring the tension of being the center of attention. Next is move your body. The more you move, the more you relax. So the best way to still your mind is to move your body. Keep moving. And next one is being authentic enough. You have to be authentic enough in your thoughts and feelings so you automatically become aware of the real you. It is very essential to do it. So if you master these skills, you can achieve a state where you have an excelled presence of mind. So the next thing is art of listening. Listening is a different entity and hearing is a different entity. Hearing means you hear a noise, but listening means you pay attention to what you hear. This is the difference between hearing and listening. So here are certain ways you can master yourself with, so you can excel in the art of listening. First one is making eye contact. This is the first rule for the art of listening, and it is very obvious, but it remains to be the frequently forgotten rule. When you don't look at the person you're speaking with, you give them an impression that you don't care for the person who's speaking and you don't care for the subject that is being spoken by the person. So it is very, very, very essential to maintain eye contact with the person you are speaking with. Second one is don't interrupt. Let the person speak. To master this art of listening, you need to halt any thoughts, be it good or bad, because oftentimes people simply need a person to speak with. They do not need persons to judge them or evaluate them based on what they are speaking. You have to remember that the goal of listening or the goal of speaking with a person is to throw spotlight on a person who's speaking. It is not on your own self. You have to be ready enough to throw spotlight on them. So this helps in the art of listening. The next one is practice active listening. Active listening is different from simply listening. Simply listening is more or less equal to hearing, but active listening is totally different. you have to demand for more explanation from the person who is speaking. You can ask questions. It is not only about listening. It is also about clarifying your doubts by demanding more explanation. And then the next one is show you understand. Nodding your head or like replying with short replies like okay, may seem trivial, but it is important not to behave like a zombie there. You have to show some interest and comprehension in the person who is speaking. The next thing is listen without thinking. It may be told in other words like listen to the person who's speaking to you without forming other responses in your mind. We should learn to be wholehearted and open-minded when listening to other persons. This helps you not to miss valuable information when they are speaking with you. The next one is listen without judgment. If you follow the previous rule, this will obviously come in line. To effectively master the art of listening, it is essential to withhold any judgment or any sort of negative evaluations. Make it your goal to be open-minded with the person you're speaking with. Listen to non-verbal communication is the next point. About 65 to 70% of a person's communication remains to be non-verbal. It is actually very much enough. So be keen enough to observe any signs of discomfort or what they're trying to tell you through their signs. And then create a suitable environment. It is the next one. You can remove any possible distractions from the place, like it may be a screaming TV or a buzzing phone. It is much easier to listen empathetically with an open mind and whole heart in the absence of such distractions. And the next one is observing other people. We've seen this already in the presence of mind module. So it is very important to be observant enough to master both the skills. The first one is presence of mind and the second one is art of listening. One of the best ways to become a great listener is to observe the way people interact with each other and all the unpleasant things they do. You can take it for yourself. If you are brave enough, you can even ask to a person about his or her likes and dislikes about you and the way you interact with people in the society. But please make sure you ask it from people who are trustworthy enough. The next one is being empathetic enough. We've already discussed enough on this topic, empathy. But in order to master this, what you need to do, what you require to do is important. So the first one is challenge yourself. Undertake challenging experiences which pushes you out of your comfort zone. You have to come out of your comfort zone to be empathetic enough. And then it is get out of your usual environment. Not to forget, humility is a key enabler of empathy. So learn to be with humility in order to master the skill of empathy. The second one is getting out of your usual environment. Travel to a lot of places, especially to new places where people practice different types of behaviors. You see different types of cultures. It gives you a better perception and appreciation for others. It is very, very important. The next one is get feedback. Ask for a feedback about literally everything, especially about your relationship skills, and have a periodic check on them. Having a periodical check on the feedbacks you receive from persons is very, very important because that helps you improvise. Explore the heart, not just the head. This is the next point. Literature has shown that reading literature that could help you explore personal stuff and emotions has shown to increase empathy among doctors. There are many evidences in literature that support this fact. So explore the heart, not just the head, with the help of habit of reading. Walk in others' shoes. Talk to others about their issues, problems, and concerns. But understanding their problems, issues, and concerns from their perspective, from their shoes, is very, very important. Being able to speak with persons is possible for everyone, but walking in others' shoes is very important for an empathetic person. Examine your biases. Hidden biases do exist within ourselves. You have to explore them. You have to explore them as early as possible because it could interfere with our ability to empathize. Remove all the biases as and when you come in contact with them. Cultivate your sense of curiosity. This is to develop a greater understanding in whatever you do. You have to increase your understanding by cultivating and inculcating this sense of curiosity in yourself. How can you achieve it? You can achieve it by asking better questions. Everyone can ask questions, but the questions you ask should be very thoughtful and provocative in order to arrive at something good enough. You have to arrive at a clarity by asking provocative and thoughtful questions. The next one is having a managed heart. Managed heart simply means working up changes in yourself, in your emotional states. Because it is satisfactory if the need for such a change is related to work we love to do. If you want, I can share a story here. It is not a story, it is just an example. Let's assume there's a nurse working in a hospital. She always feels a pride because she's a nurse. But when she has to announce a person's family about that particular person's demise, she cannot come with that self-pride. She has to take up a heart. She has to take up an unpleasant emotion. She has to intentionally inculcate that into herself to announce about that news. So that is having a managed heart. I've told you an example of a simple nurse, but this applies to your professional life. Be it whatever profession you take, you have to have a managed heart. This does not just mean about dampening the distress, but it is more about intentionally taking unpleasant emotions into your heart so that you can regulate your cognitive thinking and actions accordingly, so it will result in a better possible action of yours. The next one is self-awareness. There are many ways to be self-aware. The first one is meditate, and then write down your key plans and priorities. Take psychometric tests every now and then when possible. Ask trusted friends and get regular feedback at work. So the initial thing about being self-aware is meditate, doing meditation. Because it is the practice of improving your moment-by-moment awareness. If you cannot follow the regular inhaling and exhaling, that is very important, very significant in a meditation. It is not a problem at all. You can take a regular cycle of pause and reflection to meditate. So meditation does not merely mean inhalation and exhalation. It is more than that. It is a cycle of pause and reflection that you experience. That helps you have a fresh mind every now and then. The second one is writing down your key plans and priorities. This aids in keeping track of the progress. Just as you have a periodical check on the feedback you receive from your friends and peer, it is also essential to have a periodic check on your progress. So you can review these plans and priorities that you've written for later period of life. Taking psychometric tests. Psychometric tests can be taken in several ways, but one easy way to take it is by having self-posed questions. You have to ask yourself questions. You have to reflect on the answers you generate for those questions. You can help obtain a better awareness with the psychometric tests. It helps you know better about your characters. Then it is asking trusted friends about yourself. We definitely have to rely on the feedback of others. But make sure, again, I'm telling you, make sure you ask from a trustworthy friend. Get regular feedback at work. So asking your friends about yourself is just an informal feedback, but a formal feedback at workplace is very essential. In the end, all that matters is self-awareness. It's only with it you can get closer to a state called self-congruence. Self-congruence and self-awareness are interrelated. Only when you are self-aware, you can be self-congruent. So what is self-congruence? It is a state where all your feelings, emotions, thoughts, and your sayings come in one line. They become consistent. So that is called self-congruence. It is a state where whatever you say, do, and think become consistent. They come in one line. Next one is curiosity. Curiosity, as we've told before, it can be built up in many ways, but here are certain lay things that you can do. First one is read widely and follow your interests. Second one is polish your mind with the mind of others. It is definitely important to take the opinion of others. It is not necessary to imitate them or copy them, but do get the positive vibrations other people possess. So this is polishing your mind with the minds of others. The third one is visit a physical bookstore or library and browse the shelves, because it is very, very important to enrich your knowledge with the books you read. Reading is such a wonderful habit and it helps you increase your curiosity. Be willing to ask dumb questions. Okay, this is in contrast to what we saw in the last slide. Asking dumb questions will increase your curiosity, but only asking provocative questions will help you be self-aware of yourself. And then put a lot of ideas and facts in your head. Don't rely on Google. It is very, very important not to rely on Google or any other search engines. You have to give yourself, your mind, the time to frame ideas and facts. You have to rely on them initially, because our emotions are linked to our head. It is not on Google. Whatever you see on Google can be used for your personal academic achievements, but not for your emotional intelligence. Be an expert who is interested in everything. Show interest in whatever you do. If you show interest, you'll definitely succeed in it. Don't just focus on puzzles, but do on mysteries. So you have to be good enough to focus on all the mysteries. Mysteries are certain things that you don't have clarity about. Go, seek, explore, and find out. That is being curious. The next one to master, the last but one thing, is motivation. Acknowledge your resistance and difficult feelings with motivation. Do not run away. Do not blame yourself for procrastinating. Try to understand your style better. Don't question your abilities. Visualize yourself starting and focus on the task at hand. So the first one is acknowledging your resistance and difficult feelings with motivation. It may be helpful to write them down and leave these on the desks for you to study later, because having a periodical check on whatever you write is very, very important, and that helps you stay motivated for the rest of the tasks that are yet to be undertaken. Do not run away. Don't avoid work. Avoidance of work can make you feel deflated. It is emotionally more draining than having to go through that work. So you have a work, do it as early as possible so that the thought of it won't keep nagging you down for the rest of the day. Do not blame yourself for procrastinating. Procrastination has become very common these days. Try to become aware of the habit and gently make yourself out of the habit. Go back to the task and do it earlier. Get it done as early as possible. Please don't blame yourself for procrastinating. Try to understand your style better. We are all prone to pleasant experiences, and it's natural that we start to avoid uncomfortable and dry course. So you have to understand what is your style. It is very crucial for developing motivation. Don't question your abilities. Your abilities certainly differ from the abilities of your colleagues or friends or acquaintances. You should never compare your abilities with others. You will be forced to put yourself down when you start comparing yourself with others. So do not put yourself down by comparing yourself with others. The next and the last one is optimism. Consider what went well. Focus on goals and expectations. Record your daily progress. Practice gratitude. Come up with solutions and find the positive in difficult situations. The opposite of being optimistic is being pessimistic. Most of us today remain to be pessimistic because of the pressure from your peer or friend or family or be it whatever. But most of us remain to be pessimistic. It is one important character and attitude that you have to change about yourself, because pessimism will never, never work in a professional life or in an academic life. Optimism. So consider what went well. We can learn optimism by beginning some routine habits. End of every day, consider what went well and be grateful for it. Being grateful for what went well that day is very, very significant. Don't allow yourself to dwell on all the negative happenings of a day. It has happened. It is done. You cannot change it. You cannot go back to it. So be grateful for what went well and don't allow yourself to dwell on the negative things that happened over the day. Second one is focusing on goals and expectations. It is crucial to set goals and objectives for a day. That is short-term goals, and setting long-term goals is also important. You have to keep moving, keep increasing, you progressing towards your goal and objective under principles and drives that your mind helps you with. Every morning, think about what you have to accomplish for that particular day. This can help you be more productive in work. Being productive at work will help you enhance your skills. And then it is recording daily progress. This may reinforce other habits. It may increase positivity. This is the base of everything. Record your daily progress so that it will make you better the next following day. Practice gratitude. Gratitude is being thankful for everyone, for everything. So practice this gratitude. It is a very, very beautiful thing in life. Come up with solutions. For every problem, there is a solution. You have to find out. You have to just explore what the solution to a problem is. So start coming up with solutions. Find the positive in difficult situations is the next thing. When things go wrong, obviously things will go wrong. Things may go wrong. Things might go wrong. But when things go wrong, it could be difficult for a person to remain optimistic. It is tempting to focus on the negative things when things like that happen. But you should not dwell on how things have gone without our planning. You have to find the positive in every difficult situation possible. This is actually a mere meaning of what optimism is. So we've come to the end of the presentation. The bottom line of the presentation is emotional intelligence does not mean merely being nice. Everyone can be nice. It depends on the perspective of others. And it depends on the perception of what other people have on you. It is not merely being nice is something you have to be clear enough with. It does not mean giving free rein to your feelings. It means managing feelings so that they are expressed appropriately and effectively. Managing feelings. Be good enough to manage your feelings and emotions. Only then you'll be good enough in managing and regulating other people's emotions so that you'll be able to do something beneficial for them. Something you could do will mean a lot to other persons. Who knows? So let's be good and kind enough to everyone. Levels of emotional intelligence are not fixed. One good news about this presentation is just like IQ, EQ is not set in a stone. You can definitely spend time learning it. So levels of EI are not fixed genetically, nor does it develop in early childhood. Unlike IQ, which changes little after teen years, EI can be learned later in life. So utilize this opportunity from today on. Start spending few minutes to hours a day to increase your emotional quotient in life. So emotional intelligence can be learned. Individually, we can add these skills to our toolkit for survival at a time when job stability seems like a quiet oxymoron. So this is the crisp and gist of what we've spoken all this time. I guess you all would have obtained an understanding of what emotional intelligence basically is. It is definitely not possible to learn emotional intelligence in one single day. It takes time. It takes weeks. It takes months. It may even take years. But learn. That is what it matters. Start. Start today. You'll end up becoming a highly emotionally intelligent person in the near life, in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. You have given wonderful presentations about emotional intelligence. I hope the participants today you learned the topic of emotional intelligence. If you have any queries related to emotional intelligence, kindly shoot out your questions in the chat box. Our doctor is ready to answer your questions. Any queries, participants? Any queries related to emotional intelligence? Okay, participants, I hope we are in the end of the session. If you have any queries in future, kindly text to us. We can clarify in future. Thank you, Doctor. Thank you, wonderful presentation. Thank you so much.
And thank you so much.
Thank you so much. We can see tomorrow the same time. Thank you. Bye-bye.